Welcome to our webinar on supply planning. So just as a short intro, we will talk about different levels of supply planning in the webinar today. And next week, actually, my colleague Nick will go into more detail on the data integration flows between the different levels of supply planning, because that's also a question we often see or encounter either at customers or when we talk to potential customers. So very quickly, just the intro on Solventure. I will come back later to the 7 steps on S&OP. I want to talk about 2 dimensions in supply planning, how that, let's say, is bundled in defining a planning architecture, and then Peter will introduce a practical case with you. So for people who would not know us, this is who we are, what we do, experts in sales and operations planning. You see our vision over here. We have that described in more detail. Don't hesitate to reach out to us. And today we will primarily talk about the supply planning piece. At the heart here, you see our supply chain triangle, so balancing service, cost, and cash. And the reason to balance the triangle is to optimize the return on capital employed as a financial metric. And supply planning is probably the key piece in balancing that triangle because, demand is an input to supply planning. You could say it's an input to balancing the triangle. Inventory, if you calculate inventory parameters, also the inventory parameters are an input to the supply planning, but a lot of the inventory positions are defined also by the supply planning processes. So supply planning is really at the heart of balancing that triangle. And if you want to run scenarios and evaluate scenarios to bring to the exec as an OP, here again, running the scenarios, you can create a demand scenario, but if you can't test it on the supply capabilities, there's not a lot of use. So supply planning is also key to evaluate scenarios, and in that sense, a key to support a good exec as an OP meeting. What you can do with Arqiva, we'll come back to that later. And this is a couple of references. So if you want to have more information on this, don't hesitate to reach out to us. The vertical dimension. So you have very quickly strategic planning, budget planning, aggregate planning, master planning, detailed scheduling. So different levels of planning. Strategic, 3 to 10 years ahead. And if you look 3 to 10 years ahead, you typically don't do it in monthly periods. You want to do it in quarterly buckets, or you want to do it in yearly buckets. And here you really look at a full strategic analysis. So how will the market evolve? Pestle is political, economical, societal, technological. So what are the different type of evolutions around us that will influence our long-term market outlook? And when you make major investments in new production sites, like if you want to open a plant in the US or you want to open a plant in China or vice versa, this is typically the type of horizon you look at. If you build a new factory, it's typically there to stay 10, 20, 30 years. So that's the strategic piece. Budget, typically a 1-year horizon. So here we fix a kind of the targets for next year. We typically also allocate resources. So we have OPEX, we have CAPEX. We typically foresee budgets. We foresee budgets to invest in software or to invest in infrastructure. That's typically in the budgeting process, typically driven by finance. Aggregate planning or the RCCP. Planning not on the SKU level. Why? Well, we are looking 12 to 18 months out. So in that horizon, the specific SKU or customer is typically less important. So I more try to have a feeling of, yeah, what will be the volumes in which type of product groups, in which type of markets, and how does that map to my supply side? Does that map to my existing production plants and production lines? And where will I have excess capacity? Where will I be short of capacity? And how will I resolve that? So am I in a position to rebalance and shift part of the demand from one side to another side? Or do I need to invest in new equipment? And if I want to invest in new equipment, depending on the type of equipment, yeah, that can take anywhere between 6 months and 2 years. 2 years. But if it takes 2 years to invest in new equipment, I need to have some kind of planning outlook 2 years ahead to see the investments coming. As we go deeper, yeah, we come into the master planning. The original idea of master planning, I think, was to steer the MRP, yeah, the material requirements planning. So I need to make sure that I have the right type of components or raw materials to, in the end, make the products I want to make. And for the RCCP, 12 to 18 months out, monthly buckets are okay. If I go to the master planning, yeah, I really need to be more specific and say, well, these materials will be needed in this week because in that week I will make certain products. Yeah. In the RCCP, where it was okay to stay on a product group level, why? Because 18 months ahead, I don't care about a specific SKU. In master planning, we really decide on the mix. So I want to know the specific SKU to be produced. And here I potentially also want to include complexity, like maybe I want to group some SKUs, yeah, in a certain group because the changeover from one group to another group is more significant than the changeover between the different SKUs. So that's what you would feed into the master planning. And yeah, once the master plan is there, we can come to the detailed scheduling, which instead of a couple of weeks, looks at a couple of days. Eh? So you could almost say, yeah, with the detailed scheduling, I assume all the raw materials are there, and the raw materials have been ordered based on the master planning process. And if all the raw materials are there, then it's really about defining what am I going to produce the next couple of days. And if the throughput time in production is like 3 or 4 days, yeah, then you need to have a horizon of at least 3 to 4 days, and probably you want to plan a couple of days ahead. So in the end, maybe you have a horizon of 6 or 7 days. Yeah. If your production process is a bit longer, then most probably also the detailed scheduling horizon will be a bit longer. Master planning, you typically focus on the bottleneck. So yeah, if you have a multi-stage process and you say, well, I need to mix things or blend things, or I have a reactor, or I have a blending process, whether it's in chemicals or in foods, and then I have a filling and packaging stage. And the question often is like, which of the two is the bottleneck? Because it's always easier to manage a supply chain if you have only one bottleneck. Well, maybe let us say the upstream is the bottleneck because it's more intensive, asset intensive, more costly. So that's the one I want to make sure is planned efficiently and keeps turning. Yeah. Then, of course, in scheduling, I need to steer the operation. So instead of only scheduling the bottleneck, I will also schedule the dependent operation. Well, linking the master plan, into the subsequent steps, whether they are preceding or succeeding, that's certainly something you add in the detailed scheduling piece. Yeah. So that's the first dimension when we talk about supply planning. It's a vertical integration. Yeah. Some things to add here is, yeah, how do you connect the different vertical levels? Well, that's typically done through, yeah, talking about frozen, flexible, free periods. Typically, we say, well, the RCCP manages the free period, meaning that as it says here, typically we try to manage the supply to meet the demand, right? If I look far enough ahead, there's no constraints. I can buy any raw materials I want, and I can add any capacity needed. Yeah? As long as the business case is good, I can really manage the supply to meet the demand. Yeah? As we come closer, there is more and more constraints, and it will be more about managing the demand to meet the supply. Yeah? So supply will be more constrained, or there will be more constraints, and we need to see on how to still best meet and satisfy the demand. Master plan, what is the horizon there? Well, it's typically, what is the purchasing lead time of key raw materials? If that's 8 weeks or 12 weeks or 24 weeks, I will need to have a master plan which goes that far out. And detailed scheduling is more linked to the production process. So here I almost assume that the raw materials are there, and I'm more looking at the production lead time. So if the production lead time is 1 week, then the frozen period could be 1 week. If the longest lead time for key raw materials is 12 weeks, then the flexible period could be between 1 week and 12 weeks, meaning that the raw materials are coming. I still have not yet decided what actually to schedule on which machine. So I still have some flexibility, but it's not completely free, because in the flexible period, the raw materials have been ordered, and it becomes more difficult to add raw materials unless I have some expediting and make extra costs. Whereas in the free period, beyond the 12 weeks, just as an example, there's less constraints. Horizontal dimension is, okay, I have customers, I have DCs, I may have a downstream production, I may have an upstream production, and I may want to include key suppliers. And how do I do that? I start from forecasts and orders. Typically, I have a DRP type of solution which manages my distribution network. And then I use MRP type of logic, so bill of materials and routings, to go from downstream production to upstream production and to key suppliers. And if I want to do that, I can do that at different levels of the vertical aggregation. So where do I do the RCCP? And I do my RCCP on the critical resources. So it could be that I say, okay, one of my downstream DCs is a critical resource. If I'm a producer of tires, I have winter tires, well, building up stock of winter tires, the size of a certain DC in a certain region might be a bottleneck. I often say, try to avoid that the DC is a bottleneck, but if it would be, you might take it into account into your RCCP. In the downstream and the upstream production, you might also have key bottlenecks. That's where you want to do the RCCP. And if you would have a key supplier, which can be a bottleneck, we are working for a pharma company. They are not making the active ingredients themselves, but they are outsourcing that to a key supplier. Well, the delivery of the active ingredient, the API, that's key. If I don't have the API, I cannot make any pharmaceutical product. So managing the capacity of that key supplier is key, right? So, and also in that sense, having an RCCP which models that type of capacity over a longer horizon, that's one of the key elements to think through. Whether you are talking about RCCP or about MPS or about detailed scheduling, when you talk about balancing demand and supply, there's always a couple of typical things you can do. So I can try to increase capacity. If I cannot increase capacity, I can try to offload the demand and say, okay, well, if my DC here is a bottleneck in a certain period of time, let's see if some customers, instead of from this DC, can be offloaded to another DC. That's offloading demand. Could be done in distribution, could be done in production. Outsource, so if I say, well, I can do the packaging myself, but I can also outsource to co-packers, that's an option. And then building inventory. So if I can anticipate far enough in advance and I do have some excess capacity, upfront of the issue, I might be able to build inventory to anticipate a future demand supply imbalance. So vertical dimension and horizontal dimension are really key in thinking through supply planning. And this is how the two can come together, and then say, okay, I may have an RCCP, and maybe my RCCP is across the horizontal dimensions. It could also be in the previous example, if you say, no, I have an RCCP for the finishing and maybe an RCCP for the upstream business, or I have an RCCP for my manufacturing and I also have an RCCP for a key supplier. So the RCCP process could also be split. And certainly, if you go down to more details, the deeper you go, typically the more focused the planning will be on one piece of the supply chain, where of course bills of distribution and bills of materials will be used to connect in one dimension, and pegging will be used to connect in another dimension. This is, I think, a quite generic and logical introduction, and where it comes together when we do projects is when we define the planning architecture. Lately we had quite some discussions with customers and also with prospects around this type of schema, where on the one hand the schema shows what a tool like Arqiva can do, and at the same time, let me shift this, at the same time let's say it reveals discussions you need to have before you start investing in a software or doing a project. So we have demand, we have inventory, which feed into distribution requirements planning. So the requirements planning for your distribution network, the DRP will give net requirements to the MPS. Questions could be like, will the DRP also feed the RCCP? Do we require stock netting to feed the RCCP? That needs to be discussed, because if you say, yeah, but the real focus of RCCP is, let's say, 3 to 18 months ahead. If I would have inventories, all the inventories should be netted out in the first 3 months, if you don't have too much inventory. So as of month 4, basically the inventories have no impact and the net requirements are just equal to the forecast. And why I say this is because when you start thinking this through, it typically requires discussions and iterations with each individual company to see how this scheme really fits your specific process and your specific business. This week we had a prospect visiting us, and if you look at RCCP, they have a quite complex production process, really, with downstream plants which are doing transformation of the products, and then upstream plants which are really making primary or basic product. And if that's the setup you have, then you really need to think through, okay, most probably I need to have two RCCP processes, one for the downstream business and one for the upstream business. But some kind of how these two RCCPs also need to be connected. And what needs to be the connection? It depends. To give an example, one of the discussions I had there is, say, okay, you don't want to have too many bottlenecks in your supply chain. So clearly the upstream assets is the most expensive. So preferably you would be able to first plan that bottleneck, and then to derive the dependent plans, basically for the transformation plans, downstream plans, as a result of that. Is that possible? Is that not possible? I can't give the answer today. That's the question we asked, and that's the type of discussion we want to have to really clarify for that specific customer how RCCP would best be set up. And RCCP needs to be integrated with MPS, and MPS needs to be integrated with detailed scheduling. I won't go into detail there because Peter will give or show a case on how that has been solved in a specific project for a specific customer on how that integration works. Yeah. But what I want to let's say explain in our experience is that there's a couple of concepts, vertical, horizontal integration. The horizontal is this type of dimension, the vertical is over here. And what I want to say is it's really a discussion customer per customer on how to best set this up. Yeah? What I often see is that people say, yeah, but we don't want to have a separate RCCP and MPS. We don't need that. We only need, I don't know, one of the two. Well, my feeling is that if you take away one of the blocks, it creates a lot of pressure on the other one. So if you don't have a decent MPS, I see that the RCCP starts creeping down. Yeah? I have had customers where I said, no, we are not going to do that in the RCCP because what you want to do is actually a master planning question. Yeah? And certainly if you don't do MPS, also the detailed scheduling will creep up a bit. And you need to take care of what's the complexity, because is it possible to solve everything in one model? The answer is yes, but the problem is that it becomes very difficult to understand why the planning model proposes a certain solution. Yeah? If you don't watch out, it starts acting as a black box. Yeah? And a second thing is that if everything is in one planning model, it's maybe not giving you the scalability you want, because if you have different production sites, it's okay to have planners in those sites and do part of the planning, and maybe a master planning, you want to do it on a regional level, and the master planning could be cross-site. And when it's about investment decisions, instead of a regional, maybe that's a global process you want to install. Yeah? And that global process will then own the RCCP planning and the RCCP process. So there's a tendency also to try to squeeze everything into one planning process, and I'm not a big fan of that. There's a good reason to chop up the elephant in different pieces. In that way, you get manageable pieces of complexity. And you also need to think like, okay, which piece of the puzzle will I manage in which level of the organization? So that's a couple of general thoughts. And again, Peter will give a practical example after this. And making the link back to our seven steps. So I think at least some of the people I saw subscribe today have been following earlier webinars. So we have compiled our implementation approach in a seven-step approach, where the approach says, okay, if you skip one of the steps, typically it leads to more difficult decisions and potentially problems down the road. And the type of considerations we make here, so thinking about planning processes and which planning processes do we need and how do they interact with each other, where do you do that? Well, certainly when you are envisioning a roadmap and where to go, you will need to define a scope. So do I need demand planning? Do I need DRP? Do I need RCCP? Do I need MPS? What will I do in the advanced planning system? What could I potentially do in the ERP? So here you certainly ask those questions a first time and more from a high level perspective. And certainly also when we start a project, when we start with the design, we don't start by jumping into individual models. So if we start a project, we don't just start by jumping into demand or jumping into RCCP. No, I think it's a lesson learned from us that when we start implementing, the first thing we want to see is the overall architecture. So before doing a detailed design of demand or before doing a detailed design of RCCP, let's make sure that we have a high level architecture of the different pieces of the puzzle, which decisions will be taken where, and how these different modules and processes will integrate, and whether they will be done in a country, in a plant, regionally or globally. That's the type of questions we want to see in what we call a high-level process and tooling design and architecture before we then go into the detailed process and tooling design. So that's, let's say, again, vertical planning layers, horizontal integration, and yeah, making sure that you fit that to your specific situation and to your need in a kind of a high level tooling and process architecture and blueprint. That's what I wanted to introduce. And basically, Peter, I will now give the word to you to introduce a case to us.
Okay, thank you, Bram, for the introduction, and also for telling us and showing us that it's very important to thoroughly investigate or to do an analysis of the full planning architecture before you dive into an implementation project of an APS such as Arqiva. Now, that's also what we did for the organization of the following case. The organization of this case is situated in the food and beverage industry, and they came to us with a question on SNOP. And one of the first workshops we thought of, or we discussed, like, what are the low-hanging fruits here and how can we design your future SNOP process? And it was clear that there was both a need in the demand planning side and also at the supply planning side. Now, I think out of the introduction, it's clear that the supply planning side is not that easy to understand from the beginning and needs a bit more deep dive investigation. Out of that investigation, it was clear that in order to support that organization and the different challenges that were ahead of them and the different decisions that they have to make on a weekly, monthly, yearly basis, that we needed these two planning models, being RCCP and MPS. It's very important and also key that each of these planning models are supporting different decisions. In this case, RCCP had a horizon of 24 months, while MPS has a horizon of 26 weeks. Now, I'd like to show you today the planning landscape, or a bit the high-level architecture of what we designed. But before we get into that, I also want to take time to explain to the group why we chose for RCCP and why we chose for MPS and why not in the same model. Now, there were four main arguments to implement an RCCP process. First argument is that the organization, it was a manufacturing organization, and investing in new production lines or production sites requires a significant investment, but also a significant investment lead time. And you can't just make decisions on investing in new machines on a horizon of a couple of weeks. No, you need the full outlook on the future. And in this case, the 24 months were required to support those decisions. Second argument was that due to strong labor regulations and strong unions, the capacity in the first few months was fixed. Not capacity in terms of machines, but more in labor. And you had to think about setting up shift regimes, making sure that you're able to cover a couple of months. Because if you see for the next 3 weeks, you only need a few FTEs. But after those few weeks, you need more FTE. Well, now you already have to commit to that, because it's not that easy to just shift all the time between the number of shifts and FTEs that you need. Third main argument was that the organization was selling goods which had strong seasonal effects, and they had a peak season of around 2 months where the demand was more than three times higher than their available capacity. So there was a clear need to invest in stocks and to plan build up stock. It was even that sincere that they had to sometimes build up stock 1 year in advance. So taking that into account in an MPS model on itself is quite a challenge. The fourth argument is that they had to negotiate contracts with important suppliers on a yearly basis. Suppliers in terms of raw materials, but also in terms of capacity. So they outsourced specific operations, mainly packaging operations. And in order to get to a good contract or negotiation, they had or they needed that long-term view on their business. So these were the main arguments for them to invest and implement RCCP, and they were all about getting that visibility on the long term. Now, to get that visibility does not require to model all the details of their business. And they don't need to know 12 months out which SKU they will produce on which machine. No, they just need that high level look and their capacity requirements for that. Now, in order to get that detailed look, they obviously also needed a model that was going to support them in the next few weeks to set up the material flows, as Bram already mentioned earlier in his presentation. So they needed to have that detailed outlook on all levels of their production process, being finished goods, intermediate goods, and raw materials. And MPS is typically done at weekly buckets, and RCCP is not really supporting that. So a second argument was that they have a complex multi-stage production process where machines are interchangeable and they can run on different production lines, etc. So it was also important to model those details on the short term as well, but not really on the long term. So this is a bit an introduction on why we chose for these different models. And on the next slide, we'll explain you how the landscape looks like and how all models are interacting with each other. So I already mentioned that it was an S&OP project, and so we had a demand and a supply side in the project. On the right side, you see that demand planning block or piece. And I think we all know that the goal of demand planning is to get the outlook on future demand, which consists out of multiple components, being the baseline volume, promotions, which are very important, especially in this business, new product introductions, projects, etc. Now, if you're conducting S&OP and if you have installed an APS tool, then you can also leverage that all that data that you have available and the analytics in order to create multiple scenarios. And that's also what we did there. We had an official demand plan, but then also different alternative scenarios, which can then be matched with the supply on the supply side, which I will come to later. Now, if we look at the specifics of that demand planning model, typically, we do that for a horizon of 24 months. FMCG, food and beverage, is always in weekly buckets, or in most cases, because you have that promotion component and those projects. The level is obviously finished good. You're only forecasting what you expect to sell, and we're not selling raw materials. So the frequency of planning, typically we have a monthly process, which starts with a statistical baseline, collaborative review, and then the consensus demand plan is committed to the rest of the organization. Now, this part, I have been focusing on the forecast, but if you want to come to your demand outlook, you have to combine it with open orders, which we are fetching from the ERP system. Combining open orders and forecast gives you your demand outlook for the next 24 months. Now, then we have two arrows to the supply side, and let me start at the top. Out of demand planning, we get the official demand plan and the alternative demand scenarios, which are then being matched or balanced with the available supply on the RCCP side. On the RCCP model, we focused on the production side, and where the main goal or the two main goals were to decide on the available capacity that we are planning for the next 24 months. In terms of machines, but also in terms of people, of operators. And the second part is to determine when that build-up stock will be happening in the future and on which S&OP groups. Typically, the more detailed you go in supply planning, you're talking about the actual SKUs, but on the RCCP side, it's typically about S&OP groups, which is an aggregation of multiple products which are behaving a bit in the same way or being produced on the same manner. Already mentioned, the horizon RCCP was 24 months, which is the same as demand planning. Here we're focusing on monthly buckets because it's more about getting to that capacity and the build-up stock. And then we don't really care about when we will produce what exactly during the month. The level was S&OP group, and again, aggregation of different SKUs. And the frequency of planning here is, it also follows a monthly process or cycle, and the S&OP cycle. But on the same time, especially in preparation for that peak season, there's a clear need to also do ad hoc analysis and RCCP runs. We talked about those alternative demand scenarios. Well, it's in these ad hoc analysis that they are basically evaluating these scenarios all the time to come up with multiple RCCP scenarios as well, which are then being committed towards the MPS. Now, if we're talking about committing towards MPS, in this particular case, we are talking about two things, two decisions that are being made at the RCCP level and which will serve as an input for the MPS model. We are deciding on the capacity and shift regime on RCCP and also, like I already mentioned, on the target inventory, which gives an indication of when we will build up stock in the future and on which groups of products. In the MPS model, these two inputs are considered to be soft constraints. When you're implementing MPS, typically you're going to an optimization model. For an optimization model, setting hard constraints can sometimes lead to infeasibilities. So then modeling it as soft constraints enables the MPS model to still penalize specific decisions. And if you have to go a bit below the target inventory that was set in the RCCP due to uncertainties or variabilities that happened in a supply chain, you're still getting to a feasible plan, but not as optimal as you have decided upon it in the RCCP. So goal of MPS very shortly was to decide on which materials to be produced when and on which machines, and also to generate purchase requisitions of raw materials, which is basically an output or result of your MPS model. Horizon 26 weeks, buckets weekly, and here we are really looking at all the different kinds of products, and the frequency of planning is typically weekly buckets. As a result of the MPS, we get to the firm production orders and purchase requisitions, which are then being sent to the ERP system in this case. And then the detailed scheduling application is really looking at sequencing all of these orders for the next 2 weeks, which is typically the frozen horizon of the MPS model. So I think this illustrates a bit which decisions have to be made when you're going or performing a supply planning project, and that it's key to take time to do analysis. So that you can make proper decisions. Thank you, and the floor is yours again, Bram.
Thank you, Peter. So we still have, I think, a couple of minutes, like 5 minutes, to take some questions. So there is a question box. So feel free to drop your question in the question box. Yeah, one question which was already raised a bit earlier is here, can you emphasize or explain advantages or disadvantages of planning based on a reorder point instead of a master plan? So reorder point, there's been a whole new wave of the demand driven, and demand driven is basically based on a reorder point. So instead of basing our plan on a forecast, if nothing is consumed, nothing will be triggered. So we base it on actual consumption. And working demand driven our reorder point driven makes sense if your demand is very stable, but if you have a lot of promotions or the case Peter just illustrated, if you have strong seasonality, then working with reorder points makes you will always be lagging behind. And so demand driven or just working with the reorder point is never a solution that will fit everything. It could be part of the solution, but it will never be the full solution. And if it's never the full solution, well, there's alternatives to working with reorder points. And if you say, well, I know this is a relatively stable product, what we've done in the past is instead of changing the forecast every month, yeah, just put in a kind of an annual budget or average demand and turn off the forecast, and you will also be demand driven. So that would be a first reaction there. Other questions? So one of the questions here is, will the slides be shared? The answer is yes, if you drop us a note. So we will share the recording of the webinar. We don't standard share the slides, but if you drop us an email, Katrijn told us we can share the slides afterwards. Other questions or thoughts or remarks? If there's no other questions, we will close the webinar here. So thanks again for attending. I think this was a bit more conceptual or a bit more process oriented. And next week, Nick will really go into more detail and say, okay, if you would take the example that Peter explained, we take certain decisions in the RCCP, we refine those decisions in the MPS, and then basically we execute those decisions in the ERP. How does the information flow? So what information do we get from the ERP into the demand or into the RCCP or into the MPS? What information is flowing between demand, RCCP, RCCP, MPS, and demand, MPS? And what is the information flowing back into the ERP system? We also see that that's often difficult for people to grasp. It also often creates uncertainty, like how does this work and is this feasible? Yeah, the answer is feasible. We do that almost, as a matter of speaking, every day. This is part of our life, getting data out of the ERP, integrating the different planning modules in Arqiva, and then integrating the output back into the ERP. We've invested in data integration capabilities and a separate software product to do exactly that. And so Nick next week will take the same topic, supply planning, but more, let's say, highlight how we do that from a data perspective. So thank you, Peter, for helping us through the case. Thank you all for attending this webinar. If you would still have questions or remarks, don't hesitate to reach out to us, and we hope to see you back next week. Thank you all.